Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Avatar's online Sunday service. I hope you all are doing well this lovely morning. My name is Supriya, and I'm so happy to once again join all of us, which is our online Avatar family, from the lovely city of Dehradun. And if you're ever planning a visit, please do come say hi. If you're based in Mumbai this morning and you're joining us from there, we have good news for you, which is that, you know, the city is getting ready to reopen and we all are working really hard to figure out what that would look like for us. I know most of us would love to meet again in person. So please stay tuned on that. We will get in touch with you very soon regarding how that is going to unfold. Also, if you're not based in Mumbai and you've been joining us via YouTube, please don't stress. You know, we are not going anywhere, and no matter what, we will continue bringing our Sunday services to you via this platform. So let's get ready for today's service. We are going to begin with a time of worship. Bernard and team are going to lead us into that. And after that, Jimit is going to come and share today's sermon. He's going to talk to us about how each and every one of us are called to shape the larger culture of the cities that we are in. Okay, so let's get ready for worship. Even as we do that, you know, why don't we take a moment to just calm ourselves down, you know, get ready, take a few deep breaths, maybe try not to multitask, you know, just let's get ready to focus and sit in God's presence in spirit and in truth. Okay, let's get ready for worship.
Sing these songs with us. God of Abraham, you're the God of covenant and faithful promises. Time and time again, you have proven you do just what you said. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I remain steadfast and let my heart learn when you speak.
Yeah.
is here now, and you are the God who will be God for forevermore. So we lift and worship your name. Father, we ask that you prepare our hearts to hear the message that you have in store for us. And we ask that you continue to draw us closer to you, closer together. And I pray that you would allow us to experience you, Father, for your glory and our pleasure. It's in Christ's name.
Hey everyone, hope your day is going well. From wherever or whenever you are tuning in, we hope that today the exploration of Scripture speaks to you in a meaningful way. Today we are in part 3 of our new series titled The Vision for the Flourishing of Mumbai. So far we've covered how God uses our calling to shape us. Last week Ashwin talked about having a vision for the flourishing of our city and how each one of us has an important role to play in that. Today, we're going to look at how we are called to shape culture, look at it redemptively, and make a positive contribution to the city. For those of us who identify ourselves as followers of Christ, we often think about Jesus' great commission in Matthew, where he commissions his disciples by saying, "Go and make disciples of all nations." But there's an instruction with a similar force and authority set to mankind way before Jesus tells this to his disciples. It's in the first chapter of the Bible, in Genesis 1, verse 28, where we're going to park ourselves. It says, "God blessed them and said to them, 'Be fruitful and increase in number, fill the earth and subdue it, rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground.'" We understand the call to make disciples, helping people become lifelong students of Jesus. But what is this Genesis 1 commandment and how does it fit into the 21st century? Today, as we explore this Genesis 1 commandment, which many theologians refer to as the cultural mandate, as the Great Commission, we're going to look at what is this cultural mandate that theologians refer to. Number two, we're going to look at what are the different ways to engage with culture. And number three, what does this mean for us today? Let's start. Number one, what is this cultural mandate? As I said, many scholars and theologians call this Genesis declaration to man the cultural mandate. Before we get into this, let's listen to the definition of culture. What is culture? The customs, the ideas, belief, etc. of a particular society, country, is culture. We often talk about our rich Indian culture, or we say my office culture is like this. Or we quip the West is very individualistic in its culture, whereas the East is much more community and collective culture. But where do we get our culture from? Where does this all start? Genesis 1 tells us that when God created the earth, it was good. And to make his creation even glorious, God made creatures who would reflect his creative nature by cultivating the physical realm. The term culture can basically refer to just about any human activity. It can refer to tilling dirt in preparation for crops, organizing sound waves into musical songs, or cutting stone and trees for infrastructure. It applies to human procreation as well. Families multiply into more families, which eventually create societies and build or create culture. This is what God created mankind to do, to take dominion over the earth for cultivation as image bearers of himself. That word is key, image bearers of himself. It applies to a people's value system and practices as well. For example, we talk about some regions in India having a culture of hospitality, some companies having a culture of giving back to society, some countries have a generosity culture or a kindness culture. By this, we can say that culture is simply human interaction with God's physical creation. Culture is simply human interaction with God's physical creation. We are image bearers of God. And God desires that in all that we do, we reflect his glory as image bearers. In everything we are meant to point to him. It all starts with Genesis 1. You see, God's creative force is running in our veins. What does this mean for us? As painters, through our art, we point to the great artist who painted the sky, the vast expanse of the galaxies, and the millions of shades and colors that display. As musicians, and singers, songwriters, We point to the one who gave the birds their song and melodies. As businessmen, through our products and services, we point to the one who through humility serves and provides for his creation. Through structures and policies, we reflect the glory of the one who gave order to chaos and laws that govern life in this beautiful universe. As family members, through our love, we point to the one who unconditionally loves us and serves us. Our kindness to each other is a reflection of his patience with us. As employers of maids and other house helps, we're called to model graciousness and kindness to those who work for us, reflecting the way of our Master in heaven and how he treats us and serves us. As citizens of our country, we're called to reflect God's heart of for justice, freedom, and equality in our laws, our systems, and our national policies. We're meant to honor God's creation, care for it. And Adam, who this command is given to, was supposed to cultivate and expand Eden to throughout the earth as God's priest king. You know, and that is important that Adam was called to be a priest king. You know, in order to fulfill God's great commission, Adam had to take on a dual role of functioning as a priest and a king. And this is first hinted at when we see that his main responsibilities in the garden are to cultivate and to keep it. The Hebrew terms for cultivate and keep, when used together, are also translated serve and guard. Where else are these terms used? These terms are used to describe the primary task of the priest who were to serve in God's temple and guard it so that nothing unclean enters it. Likewise, Adam was supposed to function as a priest, to serve and guard God's temple. Adam also functioned as a priest in that he was supposed to minister to the world with the presence of God. Both Eden and in the Old Testament temple that some of us may have heard about were places where men experienced God's presence. And the same Hebrew word that is used in Genesis when God is walking back and forth with man also describes his presence in the temple, in the tabernacle. God's presence resided with Adam in the garden. However, it was not meant to just be there. As first humans, the idea was that this Eden experience would multiply. And Adam as image bearer, as a priest, that he would be responsible for bringing forth God's presence into the world. And as a king, it would be his task to take dominion over the earth, to rule over every creature. We were meant to take Eden and replicate it to the ends of the earth. And who knows, maybe even beyond. We were and we are still called to reflect the image of God in all that we do, in all that we create, in the way we relate to each other. Basically, we are all meant to be shaping and creating culture that reflects the heart of God himself. Isn't that amazing? It reminds me of a quote by Abraham Kuyper, in which he says, "There is not a square inch in the whole domain of our human existence over which Christ, who's sovereign over all, does not cry, 'Mine.'" How does this apply to us in Mumbai? Hope this cultural mandate is sort of becoming clearer to us. Secondly, we're going to look at different ways to engage with culture, with broken culture specifically. See, Adam was supposed to function as a priest to serve and guard God's temple, but he failed by sinning and allowing an unclean serpent to defile it. Adam loses his priestly role and the two cherubim take over and guard the temple. Their role later is sort of mentioned in the temple where God commands Moses to have two angelic statues forged in the Ark of the Covenant located in the Holy of Holies. You see, it didn't take long for sin to enter. The first humans failed at the task by rebelling against God's law. Instead of reflecting God's image, we as a human race keep trying to replace God's glory, seeking our own. Self-centeredness takes over every domain of our existence. As artists, instead of pointing to the Creator, we seek our own fame and glory. As businessmen, instead of bringing forth order and make life-giving policies, we use order to control our environment, and our policies are designed to serve us and not the people who work for us or the customers who consume our services. As family members, we let bitterness and hurt inform how we relate. You know, we leave a trail of brokenness wherever we go. Instead of caring for the environment, we pollute our sky, deplete our oceans of essential marine life, and cause long-term damage in the process. Throughout human history, because of sin, instead of replicating Eden, we have replicated a morphed, caricatured version of it wherever we go. Human history is proof that we as a race are not only hell-bent on destroying ourselves, but are also not learning from our mistakes. Throughout history, as people have experienced the love of God and they have sought to engage with this commandment, engage with brokenness, you know, they have seen where that the gap between what life was meant to be and what it is, they've sought to bridge this gap in different ways. And these ways always haven't been helpful or life-giving. Sometimes they have been outright ridiculous. We as people of faith have contributed to this chaos in a specific way. And throughout Christian history, there have been different views when it comes to dealing with broken culture, dealing with brokenness. And how do we engage with culture has been a hot topic of debate amongst the community. There are many ways to categorize these different responses, but I'm going to use Tim Keller's four categories that hopefully helps us process this well. Each of these categories, he says, has strengths and weaknesses. Let's examine them quickly and ask ourselves where do we find ourselves attracted to? Which position or which category helps us see how we view broken culture around us? The first view is called transformationalist. You know, basically there are people who see a culture, but they don't seek to be against it. You know, they see brokenness in culture, but they seek to transform culture by living out their faith in various occasions. They see secular work or work as important. You know, they celebrate their involvement in politics, economics, arts, media, education, and they don't see things neutrally. You know, the challenge is that they may see the worldview too intellectually, too cognitively. They may undervalue the role of the church, and they may tend to be overtly triumphalistic or overemphasize on politics or taking control. They underemphasize the dangers of power. Many of us in this, who maybe belong to this camp, or maybe we've seen other people of faith belonging to this camp, know this particular stance we take towards culture. The second way people of faith have engaged with broken culture is by means of being relevant to them. The idea is that God's Spirit is in the world to do good, so people of faith should join what He's doing. You know, adapt to new realities, learn from culture, adjust. For instance, the church may adopt newer musical styles that are culturally more relevant than hymns from the 1800s. But there's a line to be drawn in our endeavors to be relevant, right? Because sometimes people do go overboard in trying to be so culturally relevant, and the price they pay is sound doctrine sometimes or biblical-based values. People who think like this typically are very optimistic about culture, you know, whether it's marketing, psychology, capitalism, environmentalism, fighting poverty. You know, there's a strong emphasis on justice and common good. They're often critical of the church more than they're critical of the culture, and rightly so. The challenge is that they may downplay the role of doctrine and the role of the church. They may fail to be critical of culture as they're unable to see the brokenness in it. So people who are transformationalists seek to transform culture. People who want to be relevant try to seek the ways in which they can bridge culture. And number three, there are people who are counter-culturalist. They're almost at the opposite end of the spectrum. You know, they see the church as not as one of the groups that God's working in, but they see the church as radically different from all the other groups that exist. They believe that the main purpose of the church is to challenge the powers of the day. You know, they often say things like, people are so sinful, you know, without actually being able to see sin within. Look at those people, how evil they are. You know, but at the same time, positively, this approach preserves the important distinctiveness of the church. You know, it critiques other models that put too much hope in politics, or encourages members to identify with the marginalized who don't have any hope. But as we all know, being counterculturalist can make us extremely pessimistic. You know, an example of this was portrayed in the movie Footloose, which is about dancing and rock music being illegal. But the movie is actually based on a true story of a time in 1800s when dancing was illegal within the city limits. Strange times, right? Finally, the fourth approach to culture is the Two Kingdoms approach. You know, it can trace back to Martin Luther or even John Calvin. The framework here is that there are two different ways. You know, God rules the earth in a specific way called common grace by theologians, and then he rules his kingdom, you know, the redemptive kingdom, only through people of faith through special revelation. Don't worry about the heavy-duty words. It basically means that people of faith engage with the world and culture as if it's neutral, you know. They have a high view of vocation, especially those of who belong to the clergy, you know, but they can overemphasize common graves and give credit to neutral, natural things, which actually could be born only out of a Judeo-Christian worldview, like the view of human worth and value. How do you assess the four views? You know, do you tend to be triumphalistic? You know, do you tend to be try to be relevant? Which one do you find most familiar, most compelling, most troubling, and why? We share these four views so that we can reflect on how we are viewing culture in our city. Do we see redemptive elements in the culture in our city? Yes, it's chaotic. Yes, it's polluted. But surely it has created a beautiful space for people from different cultures to engage. Isn't that something about Mumbai? I would have never met my wife if it wasn't for this city. I know these concepts may be new to some of us, and don't worry if you weren't able to track all of them. But reflect on these questions. Do we tend to talk down on the culture in the city as we see drug abuse, rampant corruption? Or do we pray and ask God to intervene? Do we only embrace the culture and not call out the brokenness when we see bribery, unfair work policies, corruption? And worse, do we as people of faith live separate lives, one in the church and one outside? And this is really important for us to understand. Thankfully, there is a better way out of this, which brings me to my last point. What does this mean for us today? You see, each of these views have their strengths and merits, as we discussed. And thankfully, despite our failure in the garden to replicate Eden to the ends of the earth, God never gives up on His commission. In fact, He kept reinstating it throughout history. Throughout scriptures, we can see a thread being repeated. After Adam, we see this mandate being repeated to Noah. In Genesis 9, verse 6, we read, "Whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed, for God made man in His own image. And you be fruitful and multiply, increase greatly on the earth and multiply in it." As we see here, the essence of the mandate is reinstated, you know, along with new instructions to how to honor human life. However, Noah's descendants failed by refusing to disperse throughout the world, which is an essential component of the original mandate. Instead, they are more concerned about building a tower and make a name for themselves. Tower of Babel, anyone remember? After Noah, we see this commission being repeated to the patriarchs in Genesis 1 and other portions of Genesis. You know, first to Abraham, then to Isaac, then to Jacob, then to Israel as a people. You know, we read about how God wants to bless them. God tells them to be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, you know, rule over the earth, and your seed will possess the gate of the enemies. In the beginning of the sermon, I talked about the priest-king role of Adam. And after the patriarchs, we see in scripture that Adam was to cultivate and subdue the earth as a priest-king. And God similarly makes the people of Israel a kingdom of priests, whose task was to continue the cultural mandate through their land. You know, Moses received the law, which was a blueprint for social and cultural righteous transformation, right? We all know how badly they failed, you know, started making a golden calf to worship, you know, breaking the first commandments and bringing forth God's judgment. You see how Moses intercedes to God. He reminds God of the cultural mandate, which was His promise to Abraham that He would multiply His people. So God continues it. He starts with Adam, goes to Noah, the patriarchs, Israel. And as the nation of Israel sank further into spiritual rebellion, God raises up prophets to remind them of their cultural purpose. You know, these prophets use symbols such as temple, mountain, kingdom, and throne. And like the garden, all these places are said to be the dwelling place of God. And just as God's presence was supposed to expand through Adam's cultivation, Israel's cultural activity was supposed to pave way for God's dwelling place. Israel was supposed to be a light to the nation, but it wasn't. They were meant to replicate Eden. And even though Israel refused to be this light, it profaned God's name. You know, one of their prophets, Ezekiel, prophesied, and he said that, "I will make a covenant of peace with them. It shall be an everlasting covenant with them. And I will set them in their land and multiply them." God made a promise to Israel. He continues, "I'll set my sanctuary in their midst forever." God simply wouldn't give up. How was he meant to accomplish his mandate even though people kept failing again and again? You see, Christ fulfills forever the cultural mandate. So far in the narrative, we have seen that if we are to see the progress report of all the attempts made by people, the one word that would stand out is failure. Not one person or people that God made a covenant could fulfill the original calling that was given to Adam. Not one, except Jesus Christ. Jesus is the priest king that Adam was supposed to be. Adam was supposed to take dominion as a king, but he lost it. Jesus, by the Bible says, to him belongs dominion both now and forever. Adam should have expelled the serpent from the garden, but instead he let it deceive him. Jesus crushes the serpent in contrast and casts him out of the garden. Adam brought death into the world. Jesus brought life through his death. Adam was disobedient in the garden, and Jesus was obedient in the Garden of Gethsemane. That's why Jesus is called the final Adam, that he will succeed in God's cultural calling. Never again will there be a need for another Adam-like figure. And friends, the story doesn't end with Jesus' death. The final instance in which cultural mandate is reinstated occurs at the end of the gospel narratives, where Jesus finds himself commissioning his followers to go into the world and to make disciples of all nations. It's the echoes of the first commission in Genesis that are clearly present. Just as Adam was instructed to announce, replicate Eden, Jesus is giving his commission to his disciples, and he's blessing them. And just as God blessed Adam to carry out this mission, Jesus is blessing his disciples. The commission in Eden was to be fruitful and multiply. Jesus commissioned the apostles to multiply his disciples, and multiply they did. Adam was to subdue the earth, and the apostles were told to teach new believers to observe, and obedience to King in all areas of life was the way through which we are going to now subdue and live in the new covenant. And this time is going to be different, because God is going to be with us. He promised us his spirit through which he desires to fulfill this mandate. As we saw through the historical narrative, attempts were made to bring heaven to earth, God's presence to earth, but now his people, we would now be his dwelling place. Wherever we go, we touch and cultivate, and the world is experiencing the presence of God through us. God's mission for his church is much more grandiose than what we have been led to understand. We get caught up in thinking of God's services and relegated to spiritual activities. But the truth is, there's no occupation or vocation that is insignificant or unnecessary for this great commission to be fulfilled. Pursuits such as parenthood, business, entrepreneurship, art, entertainment, civil government, science, agriculture, education, and medicine are all elements that make up culture and should be pursued with Christ's great commission, which should be at the forefront of our intellects and our passion. Christians can do this by learning to listen, identify redemptive threads, and create redemptive things as they see it in culture. What does it look like for us to replicate Eden in Mumbai? If you are an artist, how does your art display hope and redemptive themes? Does your business create opportunities for society to flourish? Does your marriage and relationship display the forgiveness and love that Jesus came to offer? Do we care and nurture the environment, you know, the nature that the city has, and work towards its betterment? Do we as a church celebrate the various cultures that this mad, chaotic, and beautiful city represents? What about Mumbai's culture are you drawn to celebrate? What about Mumbai's culture breaks your heart and God is asking you to pray? What are you uniquely placed in terms of your gifts and talents to make a positive impact on the city's culture? Friends, our hope is that one day Jesus will fulfill this perfect dominion that he commissioned. Perfect rule and reign will be established. One day all the various nations on this earth will be made perfect. Each and every unique cultural identity will be restored, and we'll see all kinds of people groups thrive and live in perfect harmony. One day, the dissonance that we see between man and nature will be made whole. There shall be no more death of any kind. And Jesus will bring into culmination all things that were started in the first garden. But in the meanwhile, you and me here on earth are called to play our role and partner with him in helping in this restoration. Because of what Jesus has done and will do, we can all freely begin to be agents of change in our culture. We can begin to play our role in restoring governance and politics. We can restore relationships. We can restore nature. We can rebuild societal and familial structures. We can build better systems of justice and mercy. And in the here and now, we can sacrificially give towards restoration of culture. God is calling us to rise above our self-preoccupation and dream about the welfare of the city by bringing Eden to Mumbai. Come, let's pray. Father, even as we've covered so much today, God, we ask that you would speak to us, God. Let us not get lost in concepts and theology, God, but let us remember our call to bring forth Eden to the ends of the earth, to replicate Eden to the ends of the earth. And God, however you would choose for us to live in this city, reveal to us the specific purpose through which you want to bring forth your presence in Mumbai through our lives, Lord. I ask that you will help us repent of ways in which we've looked at culture in a way that doesn't bring forth redemption and hope, Lord. You would bless our hearts and you would speak to us today, God. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
So even as Jimit spoke to us about what it looks like to shape our culture, you know, is there something that stirred your heart? What do you sense God is saying to you regarding the culture of the city that he has placed you in? You know, this is a good question to engage in, and we really invite you to do so even as you prepare for the week ahead. Remember that God has placed his spirit in you, you know, and he's more than able to bring to fruition the purpose for which he has created you. Yeah. So with that, our time on YouTube has come to an end. We will now get on Zoom for our community Zoom call. But, you know, we see this every Sunday. We absolutely love how people show up here Sunday after Sunday. And we want you to know that this is a truly precious space for us. We don't take this for granted. And we look forward to seeing you next Sunday here as well. Till then, take care. God bless. Bye.